Hello everyone, today we are going to see an interesting poem. The title of the poem is The Ant and the Cricket, adapted from Aesop's Fables. The poem The Ant and the Cricket teaches us the importance of hard work and planning. The poet brings out the idea that is essential. The poem is about a silly young cricket and an ant. The ant gives a very important lesson of life during its conversation with the cricket. Students, now let's see what is a fable. A fable is a story that usually uses animals to teach a valuable life lesson, a moral. This story is typically short and states its moral at the end. Students, now look at these pictures. Can you guess the names of these popular fables? Yes, very good. The Lion and the Rat, the Crow and the Pitcher, and the Tortoise and the Hare. Very good. Students, now we are going to see why is Aesop's Fables famous. Some of the most popular fables were told by a man known as Aesop, who was born a slave in Greece thousands of years ago. The Lion and the Rat, the Crow and the Pitcher, the Tortoise and the Hare, etc. are just a few of Aesop's notable fables. So, a fable is a traditional story that teaches us a moral lesson. Usually, the characters in the fables are animals. This poem, The Ant and the Cricket, teaches us the importance of hard work and planning. Students, now let's see about the author. Aesop's Fables is a collection of fables credited to Aesop, a slave and a storyteller believed to have lived in ancient Greece between 620 and 564 BCE. These fables became popular when they emerged in print. Several stories are attributed to Aesop even today. The process of inclusion is continuous and new stories are being added. Here, inclusion means the act of including. So, the process of inclusion is continuous and new stories are being added. Collections of Aesop's fables were among the earliest books to be printed in many languages. The Ant and the Cricket. Students, here we can see the pictures of the ant and the cricket. Students, now let's know about the cricket. Cricket is a brown or black insect related to the grasshopper but with shorter legs. It is a small insect that produces short, loud sounds by rubbing its wings together. Students, now we are going to discuss the poem in detail. Let me read the poem first and start the explanation. Listen carefully, students. The Ant and the Cricket, adapted from Aesop's Fables. A silly young cricket, accustomed to sing through the warm, sunny months of gay summer and spring, began to complain when he found that at home his cupboard was empty and winter was come. Not a crumb to be found on the snow-covered ground, not a flower could he see, not a leaf on a tree. "Ho, what will become," says Cricket, "of me, at last by starvation and famine made bold, all dripping with wet and all trembling with cold." Away he set off to a miserly ant to see if to keep him alive, he would grant him shelter from rain and a mouthful of grain. He wished only to borrow. He would repay it tomorrow. If not, he must die of starvation and sorrow, says the ant to the cricket. I'm your servant and friend, but we ants never borrow, we ants never lend. But tell me, dear cricket, did you lay anything by when the weather was warm? Quoth the cricket, not I. My heart was so light that I sang day and night, for all nature looked gay, for all nature looked gay. You sang, sir, you say. Go then, says the ant, and dance the winter away. Thus ending, he hastily lifted the wicket and out of the door turned the poor little cricket. Folks call this a fable. I will warrant it true. Some crickets have four legs and some have two. Adapted from Aesop's Fables. Students, now let us discuss the poem in detail. The Ant and the Cricket, adapted from Aesop's Fables. A silly young cricket, accustomed to sing through the warm, sunny months of gay summer and spring, began to complain when he found that at home his cupboard was empty and winter was come. Here, accustomed to means be used to. Gay means glad or joyful. So, in the first stanza, the poet has described the character of the cricket. He says that the silly young cricket was fun-loving. He used to sing all through warm and sunny months of summer and spring. He was busy enjoying these days and did not bother to store food for the winter season. The season of winter arrived and he had not saved anything for the cold winter days. Not a crumb to be found on the snow-covered ground. Not a flower could he see, not a leaf on a tree. Here, crumb means piece of bread. So what happens next? He could not find food to eat, not even a small dry piece of bread. During winters, the earth got covered with snow, and he could not even see a flower or a leaf on the trees. Seeing this, he got worried and wondered what would happen to him. Oh, what will become, says cricket, of me, at last by starvation and famine made bold, all dripping with wet and all trembling with cold. Away he set off to a miserly ant to see if, to keep him alive, he would grant. Here, starvation means suffering caused by lack of food. Famine means extreme scarcity of food. Here, scarcity means shortage or lack. Dripping means the act of falling in drops. Trembling means to shake from fear or cold. Miserly means hesitant to spend money. So, the sign of starvation could be seen on his face. Here, starvation means suffering caused by lack of food. He was dying of hunger and he could not find any food around him to eat. The tiny drops of snow made him wet and he was shivering with the cold, so he decided to go to the miserly ant to ask for some help from him. He hoped he might give him something to help him survive, him shelter from rain and a mouthful of grain. He wished only to borrow. he would repay it tomorrow. So in the stanza, the cricket requested the ant to provide him some food and shelter in his home so that he could save himself from the rain. He also made it clear to the ant that he would repay the grains. If not, he must die of starvation and sorrow, says the ant to the cricket. I'm your servant and friend, but we ants never borrow, we ants never lend. Here, starvation means suffering caused by lack of food. Here, lack means shortage. Sorrow means sadness. In this stanza, the cricket said he needed this help, otherwise he would die of starvation and sorrow. Here, starvation means suffering caused by lack of food. Sorrow means sadness. After listening to the cricket, the ant said he thinks of himself as his servant and a friend, but hands neither borrow nor lend anything. But tell me, dear cricket, did you lay anything by when the weather was warm? Quoth the cricket, not I. Here, quoth means said. Further, the ant asked why he had never thought of storing food for the winter season. The cricket replied to him that he had never thought of the future. My heart was so light that I sang day and night, for all nature looked gay, for all nature looked gay. You sang, sir, you say. Here, gay means glad or joyful. In this stanza, the cricket replied to ant that he was busy enjoying the pleasant days and did not imagine that he could face such difficulty during the winter season. He sang songs days and nights and spent the summer and winter seasons enjoying them and having fun. Go then, says the ant, and dance the winter away, thus ending. He hastily lifted the wicket and out of the door turned the poor little cricket. Folks call this a fable. I will warrant it true. Some crickets have four legs and some have two. Adapted from Aesop's Fables. Here, hastily means hurriedly. Warrant means guarantee or promise. So in this last stanza, the ant then told him to go from his home and sing and dance all through the winter. The ant thus put an end to the conversation and pushed the poor cricket out of his home. The poet says that people call this a story, but it happens in reality too. Many humans spend their life similar to the cricket and do not prepare for their future. Especially in the last line, some crickets have four legs, some have two. Here, the poet compares lazy and careless people with cricket. Students, the theme of this poem is importance of hard work and planning. Students, now we are going to see the moral of this poem, The Ant and the Cricket. So the moral is, we should work harder for our own sake and for the time of troubles. Moreover, always remembers that today's saving is tomorrow's income. Students, now we are going to see a short summary of the poem, The Ant and the Cricket. In this poem, there are two characters, an ant and a cricket. The cricket sings songs and dances during the summer and spring seasons. He enjoys his life and never cares for the future. He has not stored any food for the winter season. So, when the winters arrived, he had nothing to eat. He was dying of hunger. So, he went to the ant and asked to lend him some food. He also requested shelter at the ant's home. However, the ant refused to help him and told him to go out of his house. So, the poet conveys a beautiful message that we should think about our future and plan things accordingly. If we are aware about our future needs, then we should start working towards it at the earliest. We should not be careless and should not neglect important things. Students, now we are going to see the detailed summary of the poem, The Ant and the Cricket. This poem is a work of the famous Greek poet Aesop. The two characters of the poem are Cricket and an ant. There was a young cricket who used to sing and dance during the summers and the springs. He was happy and enjoying but was silly. During the summers and spring, there is greenery everywhere, so ample food and water are available. One does not need to store any of these. Thus, the cricket was busy enjoying and did not store any food for the winters. In winters, the ground is covered with snow and no flower or leaf could be seen. The cricket passed the time singing and dancing, and soon the winter season came. Now he was in trouble as there was not even a crumb in his house to eat, and due to winter he could not find any food outside also. He could thus eat nothing but was starving. He somehow gathered his courage and went to the ant asking for help. Due to the starvation, chilling cold and rains, the cricket got wet and was shivering. Then he requested the ant to give him some food and shelter in his house, else he will die of hunger, sorrow and chilling cold. He also promised him to repay it. The ant told the cricket that he thinks itself to be his servant as well as a friend, but the ants do not borrow nor do they lend to anyone. He also asked the cricket that why did he not gather and store food during the spring and summer. The cricket said that he did not care much about the future and was busy enjoying the pleasant weather. He thought that food and water will always be abundant. While the cricket was busy enjoying, the ant was storing food for the winter season. The ant, thus annoyed, told him that he should pass the winter also singing and dancing. The ant thus quickly put the conversation to an end and pushed him out of his house. In the end, the poet concludes by saying that he thinks that this fable is quite true, as there are many human beings who do not care about the future. They thus repent when the time is gone. Students, now let's see conclusion of the poem, The Ant and the Cricket. The story teaches us that we shall not behave like cricket. We shall always prepare for the future so that in difficult times we do not have to beg to others for help. It also teaches us that we shall also be helpful to others, unlike the ant. Appreciation. Students, when we learn poem, we should know the poetic devices are figures of speech employed in the poem. Authors often use figures of speech in both literature and poetry to enhance their writings. Here, authors refers to writers, poets, essayists, poetess, etc. Figures of speech present ordinary things in new or unusual ways. They communicate ideas that go beyond the words' usual literal meanings. Here, literal means accurate or correct meanings. First, let's see the definition of figures of speech. A figure of speech is a literary device in which language is used in an unusual or figured way in order to produce a stylistic effect. Now, let's see what is a figure of speech. A word or phrase used in a non-literal sense so that the speech or writing becomes more persuasive, vivid, and relatable. Here, persuasive means believable, vivid means bright, relatable means related or important. So, what is a figure of speech? A word or phrase used in a non-literal sense so that the speech or writing becomes more believable, bright, and relatable, which means related or important. Next, let's see personification. Personification is a figure of speech in which an idea or thing is given human attributes and or feelings are spoken of as if it were human. In simple words, personification gives human qualities to non-human things. Students, now look at these two lines. A silly young cricket, accustomed to sing, away he sat off to a miserly ant. Here, silly and miser are the qualities of human beings. Silly means stupid or foolish. Miser means not ready to spend money. Students, first of all, you should get to know what poetic devices are. Poetic devices are actually the literary devices which are used is to create rhythm and to increase a poem's meaning or to intensify mood or feeling, right? In this poem also, some important poetic devices are there, which I'm going to discuss with you all students. Listen carefully. The first poetic device is personification. So what is personification? It is used when humans' qualities are given to animals or non-living things. Students, as you see the example in your poem, he pronoun is used for the cricket, but cricket is an insect. Then why he is used? Because here poet has personified the cricket. He has given him human qualities, right? In most of the places, I, first person pronoun, I is used, but actually these pronouns we use for human beings, but here the ant and the cricket are personified as humans, as they are talking and thinking like humans. Next, let's see metaphor. What is metaphor? It is a poetic device that shows comparison between two things that are unrelated but shares some common features, right? So which means two things are there which are not related to each other but they look same. It means they have some common things, like look at the example sentence. Some crickets have four legs, some have two. Here the poet compares lazy and careless people with cricket. The third poetic device is repetition. When a word is repeated more than once is called repetition. Now look at the example sentences. We ants never borrow, we ants never lend. Some crickets have four legs, some have two. So in the first line we can see ants, ants. These two words are repeated again. In the second line also we can see some, some. So these two words are repeated again or repeated two times. That's why repetition is there. Students, the fourth poetic device is alliteration. I hope you all know what is mean by alliteration. Alliteration means repetition of initial consonant sounds. Look at the example sentence. Says the ant to the cricket, I am your servant and friend. So in this line, says and servant, these two words are alliterated words. Alliteration. First, we have to know what is mean by alliteration. Alliteration is the repetition of initial consonant sounds of neighboring words. In other words, alliteration is the repetition of beginning consonant sounds. Students, now look at these two lines. He wished only to borrow. He would repay it tomorrow. Look at the first question. Pick out the rhyming words in the above lines. So the answer is, the rhyming words in the above lines are borrow and tomorrow. The next question. Give more examples of rhyming words from the poem. Sing, spring, home, come, found, ground, see, tree, me, bold, cold, ant, grant, rain, grain, tomorrow, sorrow, friend, lend, buy, I, light, night, gay, say, away, wicket, cricket, and true, too, are the rhyming words. Students, now let's read this stanza. My heart was so light that I sang day and night, for all nature looked gay. You sang, sir, you say. Now look at the question. Mention the rhyme scheme employed in the above lines. So the answer is AABB is the rhyme scheme. Students, I hope you all understood this poem clearly. Just read the poem once. Thank you, students. We will meet in the next class.